morning, everybody. Welcome to worship on this very windy November morning. If you'll please join with me in I Need Thee Every Hour, page 397, verses 1 to 3.
There's a sign-up sheet in the hall for poinsettias. Cost is $10 per flower. If you want to do a cash donation by an envelope in your pew, just put poinsettias on there in the offering plate. Last day to order is November 27th. Are there any other announcements that anybody needs to share this morning? If not, Jen is going to share with some new things that we're doing in the church.
morning.
Good morning.
I'm excited to announce that Sidham United Methodist Church is launching our new online giving platform. Hopefully you guys received an email, or you received through Judy a bulletin insert. We have partnered with a company called Vanco to give our members and friends the capabilities to be able to help further God's mission from anywhere. With this new and exciting tool, you can simply log on securely and with a few clicks of the mouse, be able to give to the general budget or to one of our selected special platforms chosen at the time. This will open a world of possibilities for us now and in the future. We thought long and hard about what this will mean for us and the doors it will open for us. For example, a recent study I read on Fox Business said that only 27% of restaurant tabs are paid with cash. That means that the remaining 73% of the tabs are paid with a credit or debit card. For our fundraisers, such as the Big Steak Dinner and summer camp fundraisers like our craft fair, this platform will give us the flexibility to have pre-sale dinners, craft booth space, or even for people to prepay for campers' entire spaces through our webpage. Already on this page that I've set up, you can pay for your poinsettias. So you could simply click on the spot for poinsettias, and if you wanted to click the poinsettias, you could buy three poinsettias. And you would click, you would put in $30, and you would have three poinsettias. In the future, we would then change the page slightly, and we would have Easter lilies. Or in the future, we would pick something like campers spaces, or craft fair spaces, or adult baked steak dinners. This will allow people that are not big check writers the freedom and the flexibility to continue to pay their bills online, as well as continue to help Sidham grow and evolve. I will be available during the week to help anyone that needs help signing up with the platform, or if you just have questions, feel free to ask. The sign-up is really quick and easy. It's similar to anything online bill pay. You'll simply click the online link that you were given. Right now, there's just four spots. It's general budget, poinsettias, food pantry, and memorials. Underneath, there's a red button that says contribute now. You'll click that button. If you're wanting to do the general budget, you will click it. You'll put in how much money you want to put into it. For the general budget, it says if you want to do it right now, if you want to do it, say, tomorrow, if you want to do it next week. And then you also have an option if you want to do it just one time. Or maybe some of you want to go ahead and contribute, say, $10 every month. It gives you that option. So it's as simple as when you normally do an online bill pay. You'll put in your bank account info, or you'll put in your credit card info. And it's a very secure thing. It has all of your SSI, very secure things set up to protect you. You'll put those things in. You also have the option, there is a fee that is charged to Sidham. Either Sidham will pay the fee, or you have the option to pay that fee for us. You don't have to, but it gives you. Do you want to pay the 1% check fee? Do you want to pay the 2.5% credit card fee? Again, these are optional things, and all of this is optional. If you want to continue writing your check to Sidham, go ahead and continue writing your check. If you want to go ahead and continue sending your cash, send your cash. This is just giving you the option. However you want to continue to help fund Sidham, however you want to continue helping with God's mission, this is just an additional way. I can tell you it's very easy. Adam and I got to be the first people to use it. So I'm excited to say it was very easy, and I'm happy to say I got to be the first person to help fund God's mission through using the online thing. It sends you a receipt. It lets me keep track of it. It tells me that this is what I did. I sent X amount of dollars, and it lets me know that if I want to continue doing that every month, I can continue doing that. If you have questions, I'll be happy to help you. I'll be happy to sit down with you and set it up for you. I'll be happy to answer any questions. So just let me know. And again, thank you guys so much. And I'm looking forward to seeing how we can grow with this and continue to work with God's mission for STEM.
Jen, I need more paper.
No.
Fine. I bet I don't need that. Thank you. Thank you for that announcement. The question is why? Why is a couple reasons why we are having online presence has allowed people that maybe have never come or have come in the past that are just worshiping online to give that way. Another reason is some will say, well, most of us will never use that. Yes, that is probably true. Most of the ones coming to church here now will never use that. But we have future generations that will be coming that pay things in different ways. So this is setting up for the future, something we do now. You want to use it, use it. If you don't, you don't. But it is a tool, just one more tool. We never want to, let me say it this way, we always want to give as many opportunities for people to give as possible. So that is why we're doing this. And you can ask Jen if you got any other questions, you can ask me as well. I've used this service before. It is on the web page. You just go on our stidhamumc.com, right there at, in the middle of the page, at the bottom of everything else, there's a little link, and in that link it says Vanco. So that's the one you know, and you just click on it, and it's going to take you to where what you need to do, and then sign up, and then do what you want to do. You may not ever want to use it for a regular purpose, but try it out and see what it's like. It's kind of fun. Well, at least I think it's fun, because I'm a little geeky, but that's okay. I can own that. So we thank you for your support, and this is another way that we can support our church. Last call for any other announcements this morning. If not, our next hymn is Sweet, Sweet Spirit.
Thank you.
for prayer concerns or joys, if you'd like to lift them up at this time.
I do have a prayer request.
Last year, a year and a half ago, I asked you to pray for my friend Holly, who had a double lung transplant, and she is now in the hospital with COVID, so we're asking for big time prayers for her right now. Her husband is a local firefighter, and he was exposed for around a certain how it happened, but so they are both ill with COVID, and she's in the hospital now. The only person who's allowed in her room is her nurse, who takes care of her around the clock. So just keep Holly and her family in your prayers, please.
Okay. Any others this morning? Well, we need to pray for our nation. Election Day is coming up. A lot of people have already voted. Benny and I voted Friday. And all I can say is it doesn't matter where you stand, that it just seems, and I hope I'm wrong, it just seems that no matter what happens, there's just going to be some controversy. So we just need to pray for our nation. We're allowed to have different opinions. We can make our choices who we want to vote for. But this whole idea of hating someone because you have a different party or you like a different candidate is not civil. It's not the way we should be. Like I said, you can have your opinions, but let's have a little bit of compassion for one another and grace, and accept for people what they believe, and honor people for making a choice. We may not like a choice, but we gotta honor people for making a choice and a decision. But we just need to pray for our nation, Election Day. If you were a betting person, the odds of actually knowing the president, who's actually gonna be the president on Election Day or the very next day, might be slimmer now than in the past, but we'll see. It might turn out differently. Who knows? Because we don't know. But we do know that we worship a God that is the one that is in charge of the whole world, that's created us and has called us to be people of love and compassion. So no matter what happens, we as the City of United Methodist Church, and all of us that are part of the church, the only thing that we need to keep focused on is that we have a mission to share and point people to Jesus. That's our goal. That's our purpose. And we have a duty as citizens of this country to do our duty of voting. But we are not identified by our votes. We're not identified by our political party. We're identified by our love for Jesus and our love for one another. And that's the most important thing. So let's keep that in the back of our heads as we get through this week. And we pray as also a joy. October's over with. And that's a joy because it's one more month closer to getting out of 2020. I don't know if 2021 is going to be any better. But it hopefully can't be any worse. But I don't know. We'll see. But let's just get out of this year. I'm looking forward to, we got Thanksgiving, Advent coming up, and some joyous time. And my goal, even though we won't be able to do things as we've always done and have that same feel for Christmas Eve, my goal is to try to make it feel as much like Christmas as possible in our worship experience, to give us some joy and something to look forward to. If there are no other prayer requests, let us pray at this time. Most gracious God, we come at this moment with a little bit of anxiety. Election Day is coming, and in the past, it was a day that, you know, people would get out to vote, a day people look forward to, but every election, it gets more divisive. It's more, there's more hatred, there's more anger, there's more discontent that takes place. And it causes some anxiety among us. It doesn't matter who we're voting for or how things turn out. We just feel a sense of some underlying anger, frustration in our nation. And so we pray for peace. We pray for civility. We pray that with our family, with our friends, with our neighbors, with people at work, with acquaintances, that we can respect one another. We don't have to agree, but we can respect one another and choose to love, choose to be graceful towards others. That is the way of the kingdom. And so, Father, we pray that your Spirit, your Holy Spirit, will help us through this challenging time that we're facing. With just the election, we have the pandemic that we're still trying to get through. More and more cases, and it just seems to be dragging on. It's hard to endure. So we pray your Spirit gets us through. Help us each day to wake up, to accomplish what we need to do, to end our day in prayer and thanksgiving that we made it through another day. And to keep praying for those that get sick. We pray for the families. Pray for those that have experienced loss during this pandemic. It's not an easy thing. And the world we live in this nation, with all the stress, people are just overwhelmed. And we pray for your light. We pray for some answers as we navigate these trying times, Father. In the name of Jesus, we pray this day as he taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let us take time to give thanks for God's blessing, and to thank God for all the provisions we have, and to pray for a generous and giving heart at this time.
ourselves to you. All that we have and all that we are. Like saints who have gone before us, we pray that you will help us be bold in our mission and in our witness. May we who have been given so much give freely, ministering to your compassion to the multitude near to us and far from us, so that one day we may stand amidst the multitude that gathers at your heavenly throne. We pray this in the name of our Savior and Redeemer, Christ our Lord.
Scripture for this morning comes from Luke, the 12th chapter, verses 13 to 15. Someone in the crowd said to him, "Teacher, tell my brother to divide the inheritance with me." Jesus replied, "Man, who appointed me a judge or an arbiter between you?" Then he said to them, "Watch out, be on your guard against all kinds of greed. Life does not consist in an abundance of possessions." Let us pray. Lord, we come to your word. We seek your wisdom, your understanding. In the name of Jesus, amen. Life, I can think, can be categorized as a choice of between living in two tents. The tent of discontentment or the tent of contentment. As I was thinking about this message this morning, I was going back to my time overseas in Iraq, and I thought about one of the ironic experiences I had. The base I was on was an army post. It was a former Iraqi artillery, anti-aircraft, I should say, base, and they had helicopters there. About 20 minutes away was our headquarters, our big headquarters, the battalion, I mean the division. And it was Talil Air Force Base, and it was mostly Air Force personnel there. And there's Army doing guard duty and everything, but it was an Air Force base, and it was the one that people would go into to go in that region. If you want to get a little clarification about where I was at, the city nearest was actually Al-Nasiriyah was the name of the city. And it did have some publicity early on in the war. If you ever remember the story of Jessica Lynch and being captured, that was the city that she was captured in because she was coming to our camp. And our camp at night, unless you know how to get there, you can't see it. It's just so dark there in the desert. So that gives you a little reference to where I was at. But what are the things that was interesting? As I said, some ironies about this between the Army and the Air Force that were between these two bases was the Army stayed in trailers and the Air Force personnel stayed in tents. Now, typically, it's the reverse. You know, Air Force, they go somewhere, they stay in a hotel, actually. But we stay in a trailer. But I have to have a little caveat on that. Is we were there for a year and they were there for 3 months in their deployment. Now, to describe our trailer was a building that was split up into three different rooms, and each room was maybe 8x8 or 10x10, something like that. They weren't really large. They had two beds, two dressers, and a nightstand in between. And that was basically it. The Air Force, though, had tents that were actually, even though they were in tents, they were actually bigger and nicer than our trailers. Well, it's the Air Force. But the biggest thing that, as I reflected on that, and I'm talking about contentment and discontent, is that as we joked about this situation, the role reversals, the one thing that we discovered was, even though the Air Force was staying in tents and we had these nice trailers, well, sort of nice, but they found out their tents were better, but they also got a substandard housing allowance for the 3 months they were deployed because it wasn't fit housing for them. I was like, well, the Army would never do that because they usually just put you in a tent, if that. Sometimes they didn't even have that. And so it was one of the jokes that we had. We laughed about it and said, wow, it must be nice to be in the Air Force. We're saying, man, we chose the wrong branch to go into. But that was life. If This was military. So we rib one another. For those that serve, you know that you make fun of all the other branches. It's a struggle for me because I've served in the Air Force, the Navy, and the Army, so I don't know who I make fun of except just the Marines. And that gets me in trouble too sometimes. But as I was thinking about that, if this was a bunch of civilians, that they had this diversity in living quarters, there would be kind of an uproar, kind of some anger, some real issues going on, because people want to be treated equally, or people want the best that they can have, especially if they're traveling. I mean, think about it. If you travel somewhere, do you just stay, and if you have to stay in a hotel, which I don't know many people that are right now, but if you do you just stay in any hotel, or are you a little bit more choosy because you want to stay in something a little nicer? Well, I'm one of those that I'd like to stay in something a little bit nicer because I like to be a little comfortable if I'm traveling. So we want nice things, but it gets to a point where sometimes we want so much nice stuff that we're just never happy. We're discontent with what we have in life. Hebrews, in the 13th chapter, verses 5 and 6, says this: keep your lives free from the love of money and be content with what you have, for he has said, I will never leave you or forsake you. So we can say with confidence, the Lord is my helper. I will not be afraid. What can anyone do to me? The message is, be content because God is with you. What else could you possibly need or want? Well, we're human. We can want a lot of stuff, a lot of things. And it can get to the point we are discontent with life instead of being, as Hebrews says, content. As we know, the world we live in, just over the years, there have been so many disasters and so many things of destruction and floods, hurricanes, fires, so forth. And we're living in this pandemic as another example. And hopefully we've discovered something in all of this, especially for those that are in church, for those that believe, that our life, as you said, my life does not consist in the abundance of possessions, because all those things can go away in a heartbeat. Life is not about what we own. Life is about our relationship with God. Yet our culture says it's about what you own. That's what advertising is all about. Marketing. That's what they're trying to put, is that you need this. And you need it now. If you don't have it, you're one that is missing out. But if you do, then you are special. We say that life, as Jesus said, we say that our lives do not consist in the abundance of our possessions, but we still at times live like it does. This is a story that Jesus he's teaching, preaching to a crowd. And we don't know all the details, so this is a story we can make a few assumptions. They may not be accurate, but we can make a few assumptions and guess some things. And part of that is because it helps us to understand a little bit what's going on. But Jesus is teaching, and a person in the crowd yells out, Jesus, teacher, says, tell my brother to divide the inheritance with me. Now, we've got to stop there for a moment and think, well, what's really going on? So this is one of the assumptions that we can make. We don't know where this one young man is in the line of his family. Is he the oldest, or is he second, third, or fourth born? Because that's significant. Because in this culture at this time, if you're the oldest male, oldest male, you receive a double portion of inheritance. And everybody else got equal of what was left. So an assumption is that this is either possibly the oldest who didn't feel he got his fair share, but more likely is my guess that he was a younger brother that wasn't happy with what his older brother may have received. If you have siblings, you probably understand that this can be an issue. So he's telling Jesus, crying out to Jesus, a rabbi, a teacher, settle this dispute in my favor. Now, a rabbi would often be called upon to settle disputes between two parties, but that's not even the case here. He just says, tell my brother to share more, to share the inheritance with me. Not let's get together and you be an arbiter between us. Just rule in my favor because I am not happy with what I have received. And Jesus' response, man, who appointed me a judge or an arbiter between you? He's basically saying, I don't have any authority to do that. That's not why I've come. I'm not come to bring possessions to man, but to bring man to God. That's why I'm here. And I'm not going to get into this. It's not what I've come to. He goes on to say, watch out. Be on your guard against all kinds of greed. Life does not consist in an abundance of possessions. The fights that families have over estates can be horrible. It can destroy families. They may have been civil at one time, but sometimes that does irreparable damage because people are not content with what they have received, what they have. A term that Adam Hamilton uses in his book is called restless heart syndrome. It just basically means that you're never satisfied. You're never content. You always want something more. Great example of this is technology. I don't know if it's every year, but I think it's every 2 years at least. There's a new iPhone that comes out. A new, brighter, shinier, cooler iPhone. Now, people that are content, if they need to upgrade, because theirs is old, they'll upgrade. People that are content see that as like, well, I'm not ready. Mine's still good. I don't need to upgrade. People that are discontent will say, I need that new iPhone. I just bought one, and I'm still paying on it, but I want to get the new one because it has a better camera than the one I have. Or it's got new bezeled edges, or a new screen, or new this, because they always come out like, look what we have now for you that is better than what you have in the past. And some people are so discontent, they might buy one every year, or like I said, I don't remember if they come out with a new one every year or every 2 years. But then, I don't know if they still do it, I'm sure they do. But it used to be really bad. People would get tents and camp out to get their new iPhone. I remember it was years ago, I can't remember which phone it was. I had 4 or 5 generations behind of the new one coming out, and mine was so, it was hardly working anymore. And they're coming out with a new one, and I was like, you know what, I think it's time to upgrade because mine's not really working anymore. And I remember this was one of those. This is life-changing new iPhone, which we've had several of those now. And I saw the line, people were waiting a week in line to buy an iPhone. And I was living in Fremont at the time. I remember when they came out, and I was thinking about people were camping out, they were waiting in line for hours upon hours. And I went over to the town next door, which actually had stuff, and I walked into the AT&T store and said, yeah, I need to upgrade. It's like, with the new iPhone. I was like, here it is. I got one, and I paid for it and walked out. I thought two things. One, it's silly to wait in line. The second thing, I'm glad I don't live in a big city. But people are discontent with life. And so that's just one example of things that people want more and more of what they don't have. We fight over this stuff all the time, this discontent. It's not always all bad. I got to qualify a little bit. Sometimes discontent can be good. In the context of your discontent with your walk with God, your spiritual life, and you want to improve that, that's a good thing. But typically, we're discontent with life and what we have. And people are always looking for what's better. I remember this Methodist church in this one town. I knew the pastor, and there was no Methodist churches near there. It was a new church to start. And every year, it was amazing, every year they had to buy some or build something new. It just grew and grew and grew. And started off with maybe 20 people met in a school gymnasium, and it grew to hundreds. It's like 400 to 600 people. And it was in that town, the church to go. I don't know, there might be one in Lafayette. I don't know what it is. We don't have to say what it is. But there's usually one church that's where all the cool people go to. Right? Because it's got the best and the brightest and the shiniest stuff. So this was that church. You had status if you went to that church, especially if you were a leader in that church. You had status. Well, that went on for 10, 20 years, I can't remember. And then, pastors changed. And at the same time, a new Christian church that was shinier and bigger and more exciting. And then everybody over the next couple years left and went to the new, cooler, shinier church. Because that was the thing to do. People are not content, even in their worship space, because they think, oh, there's something better out there. It may only look good, but it doesn't mean it's better. It may be newer, but it doesn't mean it's better. But people are so discontent with life, and we are called to be content. The greatest example of contentment was Paul. Philippians in the 4th chapter 11 to 12 says this: I'm not saying this because I'm in need, for I've learned to be content whatever the circumstances. I know what it is to be in need, and I know what it is to have plenty. I've learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want. Paul experienced the best and worst of everything in life. He was beaten, he was shipwrecked, he was in prison, he was mocked, he was hated, even by people that were believers at first. Paul experienced all the hardships of life. And God said, this is what your life's going to be like. And it's going to be like this until the day you die. And Paul said, you know what? I am content because I have God. I don't need anything else. Those are only extra blessings. Anything else. If I got food today, that's an extra blessing. If I don't, oh well. I'm content knowing I'm doing what God wants me to do. To follow His plan and His purpose. To be content. How do we do this? Well, I'll share you a few things here. These are just, you know, pretty straightforward. Nothing too elaborate. One way to develop contentment is know that it could be worse. If you have an issue, money, health, relationships, you name it, it may feel like your world's falling apart. But if you take a moment to think about it, there will always be somebody worse off than you. Always. There will always be somebody worse off than you. So when you take a moment and say, okay, I'm not really happy right now. Things are a little struggling, but it could be worse. So I thank God that it's not worse. When it comes to contentment, when you think about purchases in life, and you think, how long will this thing make me happy? The world is bombarding us with all kinds of advertisements saying, if you have this, you will be happy. And you have to ask yourself, how long will that make me happy? Because guess what? If you do buy a new iPhone, and that's just one example, as soon as you buy it, there is new technology that is already out there that's better than what you got. So you'll always be striving and chasing after something, and you'll never get the best there is, because there's always something around the corner that says it's better. So you have to ask yourself, will this really make me happy? And if it's not going to make me happy, then if it's just going to be a tool, then do I need the tool to do what I need to do? Know that it could be worse. Ask yourself, how long will this make me happy? Because happiness is fleeting. Third thing is, again, Paul says in 1 Thessalonians 5:18, give thanks in all circumstances. So develop a grateful heart. Now, we've been hearing this since we were kids, right? Say thank you. Say thanks. Give thanks. It's been ingrained in us from a young age to say thank you for things. Even, you know, think about this. If you're going to a restaurant and you have a waiter or a waitress that is there to serve you and bring your food and do all this stuff, they're paid to do that, but do you say thank you? I hope you do. I do. It's always good to say thank you for it. Even though you're paid and we can have the attitudes like, well, I don't have to give thank you because they're doing what their job is. We all like to be thanked for our service. So develop a grateful heart, a thankful heart, and say, you know, I'm going to have an attitude that says thanks. Because guess what? When we are thankful, it puts away those negative things to say, well, I could have more. But when we're thankful, we trust in what God has provided and say, God, thank you. You have blessed me. I'm going to accept it. I'm going to be content with this. And finally, the fourth thing I share with you is, find out what really brings satisfaction to your life. It is not things. I need to say that right off the bat. It's not things that bring satisfaction, but service. Making a difference in life. Making a difference in someone's life. Those things bring satisfaction. And so find out in your soul what it is that you can do that truly makes your heart sing. That truly brings joy. So much joy that you have to share it with others. That for me, one of those joys is having conversations with someone and about the Bible that they didn't understand and they finally get it. That's one of my greatest joys in life. I love doing that. I love it when people finally get it. We're all different. Find out what that thing is that brings you joy and put your energy in that and not being discontent. Again, Jesus said, life does not consist in the abundance of possessions. In Ecclesiastes, in the second chapter, it says this, whatever my eyes desired, I did not keep from them. I kept my heart from no pleasure. Then I considered all that my hands had done and the toil I had spent in doing it. And again, all was vanity and a chasing after wind. When you're discontent, you're never satisfied. You're always chasing after something. Life is anxious. It's terrifying. It's low self-esteem. It's always looking for some value that you cannot find in a thing. But contentment brings us peace. It brings us joy. It brings us that moment when we can truly rest before God because we know that we belong to God. We know that all my value rests in my relationship with God and not my relationship with anything that I own or could own. Which tent will you be? Which tent do you want to live? Discontent or contentment? A choice we have to make. Will you join with me as in your spirit as I pray this prayer? Lord, we pray that you might cure us of restless heart syndrome. We are truly sorry for the times when we receive the gifts you give us and ask of the gift received. When we are dissatisfied with the person you entrusted to our care, with our children or parents, with our homes or our car, with our health care or our jobs, God forgive us for the times we've offended you by our discontent. Forgive us for being content with the things that we should not be content with. Give us a hunger to pursue righteousness and holiness and justice and love, to long for you and for your will in our lives. Help us to simplify, to get off the treadmill and to find our peace in you. And we ask these mercies in your holy name. Amen. As we come to this time, we celebrate the Spirit of Communion. And reminded today that Jesus died for us. The body and blood of Christ was given for us. That we may know that we are loved. That we may know that in God we truly find what matters in life. That we are content. That we are satisfied. Not by anything the world can give us, but by what the Spirit of God has already given us through Jesus. So as you take your cups and peel off our safe communion measures, the top layer for the wafer that I cannot get. I'm going to have to call for a lifeline. Wait! This is so awkward. But if there, I don't know of any safer way. We have the body of Christ, and you peel off the cup. The blood of Christ laid out for us. So I invite you, as you remember what Christ has done for you, you take the body of Christ and the blood of Christ. Let's take a moment and pray in silence. I invite you to stand for our closing hymn, Great is Thy Faithfulness. practice contentment in all ways of our life, that we may know that our value comes in our relationship with God and nothing else. Amen.